Play first. Okay. So, good evening, everyone. So, my name is Kheng Meng, and I work in Singapore Power in this office here. Okay, so first start with the problem that me and my colleagues face when we work here, lah. So, in this office, we have a group of people. They call themselves the Red Team. Okay, so what do they do? Okay, so this group of people, right? They like to walk around this office, and they look for computers which have been left unlocked. And if they find one of these unlocked machines, this is what they will do. They open Slack. Slack is an instant messaging app that we use internally. And they will type basically unflattering stuff or embarrassing stuff inside there to embarrass you. And this is the symbol they like to use. So we refer to this phenomenon as burning people in the office. Okay, so this Red Team, right, there's actually a leader to this. And this is the Slack profile of this leader. You can see here, he calls himself I burn people and hunting for prey. Yeah, and this is his favorite t-shirt. Not surprised. Okay. Okay, so let's look at the trail of destruction that these people have left. Okay, so this is something they have typed like fire, fire, pants on fire, the free stuff at my desk, lunch on me tomorrow, I'll be catering, the fire burns bright this morning, and like Vina here, she had this type inside like I'll buy fried chicken tomorrow. Yeah, so quite a bad thing happening in the office here. Okay, so of course I couldn't take this lying down, so I decided why not, I should defend against this threat. Okay, so my solution here, so I have actually a distance measuring system. It's a both hardware and software solution. The hardware is here, I'll pass it down later. Then also a software side of things so that it will lock the machine whenever I walk away from my desk. Okay, so a quick demo. Okay, so now assuming I'm sitting here, right? Yeah, at my desk. Okay, so now let me walk away from this computer like this. Okay, so my computer is locked. Okay, now I go back in. Okay, so just another one more try. So now I walk away again. Locked. Okay, so this is roughly how it works. So just a high level overview first. So in this hardware device, I actually have a distance sensor, an Arduino, and a Swift desktop app in this whole thing. Okay, so the agenda I have, so I'll first talk a bit about hardware device, the Swift app, and some of the defensive strategies I employed, followed by later Vina will continue on with the improvement that she has made to my setup. Okay, so first the hardware, so I'll pass down. Wait, I don't like the computer lock. Okay, I'll pass down one sample. Okay, so what's inside this piece of hardware? So let's first start with the sensor portion. The sensor, this is actually an active IR distance sensor. IR stands for infrared. So how this sensor works is that there's actually both an emitter and a receiver. So this emitter, what it does is that it emits an IR light. So in front of the sensor, so let's say there's an object in front of the sensor, right? Some of this IR light will be reflected back to the receiver. So depending on the intensity of this the reflected light, this sensor is able to tell how far I am away from the desk, lah. Okay, so it has a range of 10 to 80 cm, which is actually good enough for this application. So I also explored other types of sensors. So for example, this passive IR. So passive IR, the difference between this and the previous one is that this just receives signals from the environment. It does not output any IR light. So the problem with this is that this has a very high error rate. So I didn't choose this. Another sensor that I considered was an ultrasonic one. So this one just basically outputs sound waves and then see how long it takes for the sound wave to come back to the sensor. So the problem with this sensor again is that I tried and I realized it's too noisy. The values I get right fluctuates a lot to be useful. So I settled with the active IR sensor. Okay, so putting them all together, so I use an Arduino as the controller inside. So the case that I use for the Arduino, right, is actually meant for a larger person. Okay, so I'll pass down these two. The Arduino that I use for this application is a smaller one called the Arduino Uno, but the case is meant for the larger one. It's called the Arduino Mega. The reason why I set up in this way is because when I put the smaller Arduino in the case meant for the bigger Arduino, I have extra space. And this extra space is the one that I use, it's where I put the distance sensor here at. Okay, then so this case is actually compatible with both of them because the mounting holes are at a similar position. Okay, so programming this, right, so I just use an Arduino firmware, Arduino IDE, something like this. Okay, so this Arduino IDE, right, is just basically I write my code inside. What it does is that it will gather data from the distance sensor and then output it via the USB serial port, the USB cable to my computer, and it's where my Swift app will receive it. Okay, so this is where my Swift app is here, over here. So this is actually called a menu bar app. You basically just get data from the USB serial port and then it acts on the data. Okay, so so it locks on threshold reach. So in my Swift app, right, I actually have some settings here. So depending on the user preferences, how far they want themselves to go away from the computer before they want the app to lock the machine. So it's customizable here. Okay, so about this menu bar application. Okay, let me go to Xcode. Okay, let me come here. So it can be called a desktop application, but to be more precise, right, this is actually called a menu bar app because it does not have a main window. It does not have a dock icon also. It only just lives in the menu bar here. So as for the user interface, right, I just use a zip file here, lah. XIB with a controller, a view controller. So it's quite similar to iOS programming also, yeah. Then there's no storyboard. Okay. Then for the serial port communication. So my app actually needs to use the serial port, the USB serial port, to communicate with the device. So actually I wrote a Swift serial library sometime back last year, in fact, at the iOS conference. So this is actually the library I wrote. So the reason why I wrote the library then, right, is because I couldn't find a Swift library that enables an app to access a serial port. So now I use this same library again in my app. So if you want more details, you can just go to my GitHub page here. Okay, then for the locking portion, okay, so I actually issue a native API call through the IO registry entry here. Okay, so this actually I got it from Stack Overflow. Yeah, so I just Google, then I found someone asking a similar question. Then this is the API I use, but the API here is actually in Objective-C. So I just translated it to Swift and it works. So IO registry is basically an API to let you access device drivers in Mac. So this device driver I call is actually the displays wrangler. Yeah. And then I'll just call it to request idle. Then it will lock the screen already. Okay, then also initially when I Googled, I found out most people suggested this particular app command line program to run. So I realized that when I run this program, it hides any notification. So the notification part is something that I will use later in my app, as you will see. So now let's try to run this. Yeah, so see, yeah, it works as expected. Yeah, but just that there's no notification later. Okay, so now let me come to the potential hacking and defensive strategies. Let's say if you are the red team personnel, right, and you see me using such a device, maybe I'd like to put a question to you, the audience. What will you do to me and my device here? Anyone suggest? Any ideas?
The sticker on the LED.
Sorry?
The sticker on the LED.
Okay, sticker on the LED, okay. That's number one. Any more? Okay, never mind. So let me continue. So the first way that I thought of, so I tried to put myself in the shoes of these red team people. What would they do what would I do to hack myself? So the first way is simple, I just disconnect the device. Maybe when I walk away from my desk, right, then they just come over to my desk and just pull out my device. So I will lose the protection. Okay, so I did think of that. Okay, so now let's see what happens. Let me enable back. So let's say if they plug out the device right now. Okay, let me do it. Okay, so let's say the computer is unlocked at that point. it will lock immediately. Okay, so let me log back in. And notice that my app has actually issued a notification here. So yes, I cannot stop the red team person from plugging out, but at least I'll be notified that something bad has happened over there. So that's why I raised the importance that why I need my app to be able to issue a notification. And the previous one, the CG suspend, right, will not show this. Okay, so let me log in. Okay, so to detect this particular device disconnect, I use, okay, let me, this USB watcher. Okay, so actually I copied this code from Stack Overflow lah. So let's see the link. Okay, so again I googled that, I found, yeah, so someone had this problem. Is there a delegate in suite to let my class know when device are plugged in via the computer USB? So the reverse is also true lah. This API that the answer is given can also detect that a device has been plugged up. Okay, so let's go to it. So this is the answer that I settled on. So the answer here, they say that they have actually a USB watcher class. Then you just need to use the code. And what it basically does is that it hooks onto the operating system API. So whenever you plug out or plug in the USB cable, so the operating system will inform the app. Then all I had to do was to, in my view controller, implement this USB watcher delegate. And then my controller will know that this my device has been plugged out. Then from there, I just act according to it. Okay, so yeah, auto reconnection. So once I plug out, right, so let's say if I plug it back in. Yeah, so my app is able to detect that my device is being plugged back in and then connect back to it again. So you save the trouble. So in my earlier iteration of the app, I didn't have this feature. So I had to actually come here, then connect myself. So I realized I need this auto reconnect back. It saves me a lot of trouble. And also, in fact, sometimes when I leave my desk, I need to take my laptop off of my desk to go meet someone, then I bring it back, when I connect back the device, auto-connect back. So it saves me, yeah, a lot of trouble also. So, maybe the hack number two. Yeah, so this is...
The phone gets a 90 for that specific...
Whenever a USB device connected back...
Any USB device connected back,
this API will tell my app that. So I actually had to filter. I want to look for only USB serial devices. Okay, so that's number one. So, but the thing is, sometimes a user can have multiple USB serial devices. So the second filter is actually by the path. Okay, so the path is here. CU USB port 1411. So actually, this path is actually constant throughout the time that the computer is booted up. Because the moment you reboot your machine, this ID can change. Yeah, so, but let's say don't shut down your computer, it's fine. So if I connect back, I see that this particular path exists again, then I'll connect to that path. Okay, so yeah, so Rahim, he suggested that maybe someone can tamper with device, like putting a sticker there. Okay, so I don't have a defense against that, but then, so I actually require the user to be vigilant. So you notice at here, right, actually I show a live display of what's the reading of my device. So let's say now I move this device slightly further away, right? Okay, oh, it locks already, sorry. Let me disable locking mode. Okay, let me increase it first. Okay, so now say I move it further away, you can see the distance increases. Then when I move it closer to me, shorter, yeah. So if let's say, if you're a user, right, you're using this app, right, and then I mean, when you're using this app, when you're at a desk, right, you probably have an idea of how far you are away from the desk. So one day, if somebody decides to put a sticker there, immediately the distance here will show a very small value. You immediately realize that something is wrong already. Yeah, then you, of course, go and check the device. Did somebody tamper with it? Okay, so that's for hack number two. Okay, so I did talk of another one more hack, which is the malicious person can actually reprogram my Arduino to give false values. Okay, so my defense against it is that I will always reprogram this hardware before using it. Okay, so this is how it works. So this is my Mac app. It actually contains the firmware binary of this Arduino. So now I go to my Xcode. You see this file here? Yeah, this binary file. So actually I store this firmware binary inside. So what happens is that whenever I want to use this device, my Swift app will then program the Arduino with this firmware binary. And the way I do it, right, is through the Arduino app. So I didn't use the Arduino app directly because the Arduino app itself is actually a GUI program. But inside this Arduino app, there's actually a programmer binary called AVRDude. So what my app does is you call this binary directly with this firmware file name as a command line argument, and then this AVRDude will then reprogram Arduino. So even if there's any malicious firmware inside, right, it will be swept away and reprogrammed a fresh one every time. So let's see my app here. So this is actually the, you can see I actually call this command here, right, the AVRDude inside with this following command line parameters. Yes. So that's why let me now I'll disconnect and then reconnect again. Let me show you. So disconnected. So you notice here, my app will flash the Arduino first. Then after that, come on. No, sorry. The second notification went out. Yeah, so here, you can see here. So after that, then you connect to it and then you use its values. Yeah. Okay, so there's actually a possible way to hack my system without me knowing about it, and that is actually to override the Arduino bootloader. So this is actually quite a technical portion. So if you're not sure, because I know most of you here are not hardware people, so if you're not sure about it, just feel free to ask me the questions. Okay, so in typical Arduino programming, right, there's actually just, it's very simple. All you need to do is you just start up your Arduino IDE, something like that, write your code inside it, then just click upload. Then let's say if your Arduino is connected via USB cable, then the Arduino IDE will straight away push this firmware inside here. Very simple. But this simplicity of programming is actually very rare lah. Actually, most of the times, like, if you program commercial microcontrollers, you need dedicated system programmers. So something like this. So this is called an in-circuit system programmer. So for Arduino, actually, there exist some pins for you to do that lah. So what you do is that basically you push your firmware through this programmer inside directly. Okay? So this simplicity actually comes at a price. Because we need to see how this thing works, right? So in Arduino, right, in the Arduino board, at the factory, what they do is they program a bootloader inside before they ship it out to you. So what this bootloader does is that it will listen on initial startup for 1 second, it will listen to instructions from your computer. Then let's say if at that point you want to upload that firmware inside, then you take that firmware and then basically burn it to itself. So this is how it's done, quite simply. So the problem is, if you can find some way, right, to override that bootloader, right, the Arduino can pretend to be flash, but in reality, right, it is not. Yeah, so you can basically have a malicious firmware inside all the way. And this can be done if you use the ICSP, this one here. You can actually flash the malicious bootloader inside. So I hope that my evil colleagues will not resort to this because there's no defense against this. Okay, so now before I pass the time to Vina, right, actually Vina is actually my colleague and also one of the users of my setup. So while using that setup, she's actually found certain flaws in my setup here, in my app, and in my app. So she suggested to me, maybe I can change things in a certain way. So as she's a Swift iOS developer, right, I issued a challenge to her, why not she make the changes herself and then issue the pull request to me. And that was what she did. So for that, right, so now I pass the time to her for her to talk about the improvement that she made to my app. Okay, yeah, Vina.
All right, thanks, Kheng Meng. Actually, when Kheng Meng offered me to try on this device, in my thinking was like, oh, this must be a perfect device, right? He's smart. But after some time when I use it, right, as you see here, this is the first version one, right? Version one that he gave it to me. When I look at the locking distance, right, wow, I find such a long options of centimeters, right? That's the first impression after some time of using it. So I find it that, oh, maybe if the distance options can be shorter, because this one is like 10 to 80, that would be better. And then the second time is that I move frequently. For example, because our table is like this, right? Whenever I move for example, like that, then the device immediately locked. And I feel like a little bit annoyed because, hey, I just leave the desk for probably 3 seconds and then it really suddenly lock it. That's why I keep entering my password again and then again and again. It's like, to me, it's like, what's wrong with this one, right? I don't like keying password, you know. So after that, after he issued the challenge, right? All right, I will take a look at the code, right? Actually, the way you take a look at the code is that you click here and then he put a fingerprint here called source URL, and then it will open his source code. So actually, if you want to learn how Kheng Meng make the menu bar app, right? You can actually clone this one or fork it. Actually, it's pretty straightforward, right? So I have two challenges or two homeworks from Kheng Meng that day, right? It's actually not a flaw, Kheng Meng. You cannot call it a flaw. It's just a little improvement, right? So the first challenge is how to shorten the locking distance. I wanted to say, okay, maybe not per 1 centimeter. Can I make it every centimeter, every 5 centimeter instead of 1 centimeter, right? So I take a look at his code, Swift code, obviously, and he does it by this code. It's like the normal way, like 4 distance in the minimum to the maximum and add it as the menu. And therefore, he has this kind of like 10, 11, 12, blah, 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 right? So the usual way of me wanting to make it every 5 centimeter difference is this way, right? I make a var option equal to 5, and then there is his distance, minimum constant, maximum. And then I do this kind of, you know, for loop iteration. And then if you put it in the playground, right, it will print out the correct sequence from 10 to 80. But because like this is my first contribution to open source, you know, I want to do it more elegantly. You know, like I'm a iOS developer, so I was thinking, like, is there any better way to rewrite that for loop into a better way, right? And then I find this function called strike in the Swift API reference. Basically, as it says, right, strike will allow you to generate a series of value whereby you can add it with a constant step. So after trying, then I get to replace his one-liner with my one-liner here called for distance in strike from the minimum through the maximum by 5. And just by changing that one liner, actually I managed to issue my first pull request, simplifying this menu from this to this one, which is nicer, right? So I was like, wow, so happy. Even Kheng Meng was like so happy. It's like, wow, I got a first pull request. Okay, fine. Right, so we continue with the second challenge. The second challenge that I know is like a little bit tricky, because the second challenge is I don't want this thing to lock it immediately, but how to prevent that? So I'm thinking, okay, maybe we should have a locking delay, like how our iPhone has the display auto lock, right? And then I wanted to have like, let's say about 2 minutes or 5 minutes. Then Kheng Meng say, you crazy, but within the 2 minutes and 5 minutes, you know, you can get burned again, right? Okay, fine, what do you want? So he suggested, okay, let's have 0, 1, 3, 5. Okay, fine, whatever you want, right? But then like the trick is like, how do I do it, right? This is just to simulate to you, for example, a 3 seconds delay, right? Each dot here is marked by 1 second. Whenever you go out of the distance, I mark it as a T1. And then it will count one, two, three, and when I get back within a distance, it's not going to lock. The second scenario is that when I go out of distance, I count to whatever, example is 3 seconds, and if I never go within distance, I will calculate the current time minus the T1. If it is greater than the 3 seconds, go to lock. Right. Now, let me show you the code which confused me. Oh, I have to quit first.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So the locking distance is here and the locking delay is here, right? So right now the delay is 0 and then let's say I put this one.
No,
yeah. So make it the T, then within 0 second it's locked right away, right? And then now I set it to 3. Then when I do that, there's a notification saying that locking in 3 seconds. It will count 1, 2, 3 and then lock. Right? Sounds cool. But when I look at his code, right, I was like, wow, so upset. The reason why is that, although I know that he start everything in this, the logic is in this one menu controller. I will show you what confused me. I quit this one first. By the way, if you clone it, right, then maybe you are like me, right? I don't know how to test it because when you have a iPhone app, you always have a simulator. By right, you don't need a simulator. You just click build here and then it will install it in your menu bar right away. Okay, like this. Is it flashing? Oh, okay. Right. So as you see, right, this current distance is called from this function called distance receive, where I have a print. So the sensor actually take note of the distance is like every 2 times every second. See the moment. Okay, I have to. When I put this away, right, it straight away like taking note of the new distance, but it keeps shooting the current distance. So to my confusion is like, okay, so how do I take note of my T1? You know, I was like totally confused. How do I take note of the T1? And after the T1, right, how do I know this difference, the current time minus T1? So there goes my hypothesis about, okay, what Swift function should I use? But the story is short, right? I actually find a way that is to use this thing called CF absolute time get current, right? This is the code. The logic is that if you are in the locking mode and your distance is greater than the current locking distance, which the current locking distance is this one, it will start to count like this one. Okay, when you are out of this distance, start counting, and then this one will determine whether you are starting or not. You are not starting. When you are not starting, I will get the time difference. And when the time difference is greater than the timeout, do the actual locking machine. Yep. I guess that's as simple as that, right? And if you want to look at the code, right, you can actually go to his GitHub here, and then there should be a pull request here, and then you will know like what are the codes that I proposed to Kheng Meng and how did I add the menu and stuff like that. So to my surprise that actually Mac menu bar app is relatively easier than the iOS app. Sort of like, yeah. So after that, I find this way, if Kheng Meng doesn't like 0, 1, 2, 1, 3, 5, I can always extend it myself, you know, like I can always like change the code myself then to my requirement. Right. So I mean, in conclusion, it teaches me how do I contribute to the open source as well. Right? Okay, I'll return it to you.
Okay. So this is actually a final statement for me that actually hackers always win. So why did I say that? It's because I don't actually have physical security on my device here. Yeah. So basically, right, if anyone can come to my desk, right, basically my colleagues, they are working here, they can access to my desk. If I'm not around, they can just tamper something inside there and I don't know. Yeah, so actually I don't have any security at all. But the thing is, what I can do is actually basically raise the bar of burning so hard that they would rather not come and burn me instead. They rather go and I basically shift the risk to other people, other unprotected colleagues. Okay? Okay, so yeah, that's all from us, for both of us. So any burning questions? Anyone? Okay, no questions? Okay, yeah.
How difficult is it to access to the webcam?
That's actually a very good question. So not that hard. So what actually some of my other colleagues did, right? I'm not the only one who came up with defense. One of my colleagues from the data team, what they did was actually they basically they accessed the webcam. So what they do is that when they access the webcam, they get a live feed of the video from the webcam and they'll compare it to images. So for example, one of the strategies is that if they detect the leader of the red team, then they will lock the machine. Or another one is they detect that there's no faces in front of the machine, they lock the machine. Or if they detect that their face is in front of the machine, then they unlock the machine. Yeah, so this, yeah, so someone actually did something similar to that. But then again, the thing is about webcam is that when you use the webcam, the LED turns on, right? The green LED turns on. So some people actually may find it quite irritating. Then who's to say that it's not your app, not your own app is using the webcam. Maybe some other malicious app is using the webcam. You can't tell the difference. And also, I think there's also some false positive cases. So someone you take a picture of you, then they go in front of the machine, yeah. The kind of thing. Yeah, okay, yeah. Any more questions? Okay.
Can I keep them?
No, I want it back. Okay, so that's all. Yeah, hand it back to Melvin.
Okay, thank you, Kheng Meng and Vina.